Simon & Schuster Audio presents Sam, One Robot, A Dozen Engineers, and the Race to Revolutionize the Way We Build by Jonathan Waldman. Read by Corey Brill. Prologue. Though the invasion began from both coasts, it proceeded unnoticed for years. For most of two decades, amid the Cold War and the riots in Vietnam and stagflation, it advanced in obscurity. An automobile factory was taken over here, a candy factory there. But by the 1980s, the robot invasion was unmistakable. Robots were everywhere. They were on lunchboxes and t-shirts, in comics and video games. Nintendo made one. Radio Shack sold a couple. Across movie and TV screens, robots were veritably plastered. Mork brought one home for Mindy to meet. Mr. Rogers visited some. One, named Sam, rolled onto Sesame Street and insisted it was on Mulberry Street. Notwithstanding the pallid, humorless one in Star Trek, they had personality. Those in Sleeper kvetched, the squat one in Star Wars sassed, and David Hasselhoff's, in control of a badass Pontiac Firebird, had an ego as soft as French cheese. Connected to a vast network, the one played by Arnold Schwarzenegger was powerfully sinister, while disconnected and on the run after being zapped by a lightning bolt, Johnny Five was alive. So, in the end, was RoboCop. Off the screen, they behaved more rudimentarily. One walked, one rolled down hospital hallways, one vacuumed, and another climbed stairs. In Atlanta, one sang at a lounge. Yet others presaged a brave new world. Two robots investigated the contaminated reactor at Three Mile Island, and another, which had found vents deep on the ocean floor, also found the Titanic. A NASA crew used a robot to knock ice off the side of the shuttle Discovery, and the Army employed a robot to load 100-pound howitzer shells. A $40,000 Swiss gizmo helped cops in Texas dole out speeding tickets. In Maryland, where I was then growing up, a stubby fiberglass one delivered a commencement address. Computers, it said presciently, are now a part of us all. I already knew as much, because my father had written a whole dictionary of robotics. It had 2,000 entries for terms like Denevit-Hartenberg matrix and Karhunen-Loew transformation, and cited no fewer than 24 robot programming languages because there were more of them than native tongues of North America. At IBM, roboticists used Emily. At Stanford, they programmed in Noah. At GE, they used Help. Dad's dictionary explained biquinary systems and bang-bang machines and even a processing conundrum known as the deadly embrace. Robotics was hot stuff, and more absurdly named than the languages were the robots themselves, the Locoman, the Pragma, the Nebot, the Grivet 5, the Prab 5800, the Syro 2000. It was enough to make an innocent suburban boy think Voltron was real. 400 miles north, in farm country east of Buffalo, New York, a boy the same age was similarly fascinated. He was obsessed with toy robots, in particular Transformers, which did noble work and blended in with society. The little plastic toys came with tech specs, which suited a kid already enchanted by calculator watches and remote-control cars. This boy, however, was the descendant of some very inventive and courageous and stubborn men, and he had bricks in his blood. 20 years later, by which time the kid had become an engineer and Roombas had invaded America's living rooms, he was posed a simple question. What did he think of a robot that laid bricks? At the time, two sophisticated robots were exploring the surface of a distant, brick-tinted planet. But what initially came to mind was some amalgamation of the nicely packaged, articulate, intelligent contraptions he'd absorbed as a boy. Something faster, smarter, tougher, more responsive, more precise, and more capable than humans. He had never laid bricks. He had never built a robot. He said, "I think that's a good idea." Part 1. Victor. 1. The First Brick. By the fall of 2013, Scott Peters had spent nearly a quarter of his life anticipating a brick. It was the first real brick, and at a quarter before noon on the last Friday in October, on a west-facing wall in a suburb southeast of Rochester, it finally went down. There had been other bricks, but they were mere practice bricks, not permanently bonded components of an actual building. To Scott Peters, the first real machine-laid brick, not just his first, but the world's first, seemed monumental. So, on the deck of a steel scaffold, he squatted, removed a glove from his right hand, held out his iPhone, and captured what people there once called a Kodak moment. Scott, 35 years old and over 6 feet tall when upright, was wearing jeans and leather boots and a mud-smudged green jacket, and, to insulate himself from the cold of western New York, a warm blue beanie beneath his white hard hat. Beneath the beanie was the same close-cropped swimmer's haircut he'd had since childhood, and beneath the haircut and a scruffy beard was a boyish, toothy, open face. As the first brick went down, he was too focused and too exhausted to smile. Without saying a word, he pressed record. He captured the motion of a unique contraption. Sitting on a pair of vertically aligned roller coaster rails, it resembled neither vehicle nor construction equipment. 10 feet tall, it loomed over everyone on the scaffold like an elephant. From one of its sides, an electrical cord, an airline, and a water hose ran to the puddled ground. From another, a mechanical crutch, a peg leg, basically, pointed down. There was cardboard taped to part of it, a heating pad wrapped around part of it, and mortar slowly leaking from another part. A massive steel cabinet hid a tangle of circuitry. Style-wise, the contrivance had a lot more in common with a treehouse cobbled together by 10-year-olds than an iMac or even a minivan. 2 screen gates, more or less chicken wire, ensconced the thing, and a rolled-up silver tarp covered it. Under the tarp, a gargantuan articulated silver arm made in Switzerland began to bend at the elbow. Above the elbow, on the arm's bicep, was a white sticker that said Construction Robotics. Below the elbow, there was a mechanical claw that grabbed a brick from a seesaw-ish table at the end of a conveyor jutting out from the machine's left side. The arm swung around and brought the brick to a central plastic nozzle. The machine hissed for 5 seconds and squirted mortar onto the bed of the brick. The brick was a utility brick, 3 5/8 inches by 3 5/8 inches by 11 5/8 inches, made in Ohio by the Belden Brick Company of clay dug from deposits laid down in the last ice age. It contained 5 square holes and weighed 10 pounds. It was unremarkable, and yet. The arm twisted and extended beyond the edge of the scaffold, across 2 wooden planks, and into the crisp autumnal air. It descended toward the left side of a short factory wall and, as it did so, rotated the butter side down. Some mortar fell off in dribbles. As the arm lowered toward a band of white stone, it slowed as if coming in for a landing, and 2 red laser dots appeared beside the gripper. "Holy crap," someone said. At touchdown, there was a hum like the first half of a siren's wail, and then the gripper opened and the arm rose. Someone else yelled, "Woo!" The brick remained where it had been placed. One small part of an otherwise good-looking, weather-resistant, durable edifice. The whole movement, from pick to butter to place and back, took 50 seconds, which was, as far as paces went, far from record-setting. A human mason could have picked, buttered, lit a cigarette, taken a drag, shot the shit, scratched his ass, kept tabs on his foreman, looked out for OSHA, and still placed his brick before 50 seconds had elapsed. The world's fastest bricklayer could have placed a couple dozen bricks in that time. Scott Peters, an engineer so persistent that he'd never put the word "that's" before the word "impossible," said nothing. He had aspirations far beyond 50 seconds and dreams that involved much more than short factory walls. He wanted to revolutionize construction, the second biggest industry in America. But first, he attended to the second brick, because after 50 seconds of glory, his 5,000-pound bricklaying machine was stuck. In the scheme of things, the inauspicious debut was a predicament of minor technical consequence, and yet a lot hung in the balance. Not just for Scott, but for America. Brickwork, having endured decades of decline, was disappearing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.